for everyone that's watching, this is Juli Inkster. And for those of you that don't know Juli, Juli and I came on tour at the same time all the way back in 1983. a really long time ago. Juli won 31 tournaments, 7 majors, career Grand Slam, Hall of Fame. Like, she's, you know, she's the real thing, right? I'm proud of her. Yeah. Done great. Not only, and when I say Juli won tournaments, Julie's still playing the LPGA tour. So more power to her. I don't know how she does it.
Very little.
Still doing it, sister. You're still doing it.
So. Yeah.
And, but in the meantime, she's also rehabbing from what? A knee?
Knee. Yeah. Yeah. When I was working out, I always jump rope, and my knee was kind of bugging me a little bit, but when I was jump roping, it just kind of popped. So I had surgery 2 months ago, and you know, I'm doing the bike and walking a little bit. It feels pretty good. So, you know, the older you get, the little harder it is to rehab. But if I was going to get hurt, this is actually the best time to do it.
Yeah, I mean, I hate to say it, but it is, right? When do you think you'll be able to get up and start kind of playing and, you know, starting to practice and stuff?
Well, they say I can chip and putt now, which, you know, I love to do anyway. So, but all the courses are closed here. So, I've just kind of been just messing around the backyard, but not really doing anything. Probably another month before I can start really, you know, with that swing speed I have, really going after it.
You don't want to damage that knee, because you could. Well, really, speaking of these crazy times, you know what? You know, I know you're rehabbing and whatnot, but what else? I mean, what else are you doing? You know, like anything like thing or different? Are you doing any hobbies or what?
I have to say, I'm getting out of bed a little later than usual.
Yeah.
I still do a workout. I got a little workout at home. You know, some bands and some weights. So I do a lot of upper body. I'm trying to right now go through walks, but I've been reading a lot. You know, I think I'm on my fifth book. I've been cooking a lot. We cook every meal. So, I send Brian to the store and then I cook it. Yeah. He's probably the one that's in that little, he thinks I'm trying to get rid of him, but he gets up early, so he takes the dog, and, you know, so we've been doing a little more walking now that I can walk. This is probably the most time we have ever spent together, 24/7.
That's amazing. I think that's true for a lot of people.
Yeah.
It's a bit of a game changer with people, and, you know, and my kids are being homeschooled at home, and it's just, you know, totally different way of life. And the amazing thing is that everyone's doing it, you know?
I mean,
just, oh, there's a few of us doing it. It's like, no, everyone, you know, which is.
And I think the hard part was the first couple weeks, but then once you kind of get into a little routine and, and a little groove, that helps out. I think the hardest part, not only for us, but for everybody, is just the whole social part of it. Just, you know, being able to have a drink with a friend, or having people over for dinner, or having a play date, or with the kids, or something like that. I think that's, I mean, especially for the older group. I know a lot of them, and we're old, but the next group, you know, they rely big time on being social and getting out there, and you know, now they're hunkered down, and I really feel for them a lot.
I agree, Juli. It's really been interesting. And really, while we were waiting for you to sign on, I was saying that the reason why we wanted to do this is just have something to do and create
some
conversation. You know, it's like everybody's looking for something to do, you know?
So, yes.
So we thought,
and everybody's starved for sports, or I mean, I've watched a lot of cooking shows.
I know. Hey, okay. So I want to talk about the format of this. So what we're going to do is we're going to do what we call a quick nine, right? I'm going to ask you 9 questions, all different stuff. And, you know, and you and I kind of go from there. But I'll start with my first question, because you're talking about sports. We got the draft tonight, right?
So yes.
The NFL draft. Who do you think is going to go first?
Definitely the quarterback from LSU will go one. And I think the defensive back from the defensive lineman from Ohio will go two.
Yeah.
But the third one is Meg Mallon's team, the Detroit Tigers. I mean, Detroit Lions. They might trade that pick. And if they trade that pick, it could mess everything up. My Niners have the 13th pick. How about your Buccaneers Brady and Gronk?
And Gronkowski this past
week. I know. Crazy. Oh, my God. The band is back.
I know. It's awesome. It's awesome.
You guys are going to have a great offense. Your defense might be a little bit, but you're going to score some points.
Yeah. I mean, we actually have a pretty good defense. I mean, they were just overshadowed by kind of our situation last year, but we do have a great offense, so it's going to be a fun year for sure.
Yeah.
So
I can't watch
the draft because there's nothing else to watch. So
I know, but I think I've been listening to some podcasts and some of the coaches how they're setting up their war room, right? And you've seen, it's impressive.
Yeah.
I mean, we just have to do this. Can you imagine trying to do a whole draft?
No, I can't imagine from home.
I mean. It's someone like John Gruden who knows nothing about any. I don't know how a lot of these people are going to do it.
I know it's gonna be really interesting. I think that's gonna be kind of the fun of it tonight.
Exactly.
Biggest audience.
Exactly. I can't wait. I might even have a cocktail.
Let's get started. All right, Julie, let's go to golf, okay? What is your most memorable shot? Where was it, and why was it memorable?
My most memorable shot. Boy, that's a good one. I have to see probably a shot that kind of changed my career was at the U.S. Open in 99 at Old Waverly. I had, I think, a four-shot lead go in the last round, and I've never won an Open before, and I'm 39 years old, and I was kind of leaking a little oil, and I hit it in the bunker, and it plugged, and I'll never forget it. It's not a lot of shots that I practice, but I just kind of winged it, and I knocked it out there close and ended up having a little chat with myself and went on to win it. But, that was probably wasn't my best shot, but it was probably one that maybe changed my career a little bit.
Yeah. I mean, the best shot, we've all loved, we're fortunate, like we play on tour, and hopefully we hit a lot of good shots, but it is those one or two shots. So on the flip side of that, is there one that you hit that you'd like to take back? One that you're
my God. I've had so
like
many
one,
of those.
But like that one, that one.
I'll tell you a funny story. It was my rookie year and we were playing at St. George's in Toronto. And the Canadian, and I was leading, and on that, I think it was the 16th hole. It was like a long par three, and I shanked it out of bounds. And I had to drop I had to re-tee, and I ended up hitting it on and making birdie for a bogey. And then I went on to win the tournament.
Oh.
But I've hit my share of shanks and chunks. Yeah, I mean,
have you ever hit anyone with a shank?
No,
I have.
Oh, yeah.
I can't remember the name. It was in Japan, and I can't remember the girl's name. But I hit somebody right in the rib. It was I thought I killed her.
I tell you, I think that's the hardest shot after a shank is the next one.
The next one, absolutely. Yeah. The fact that you made a bogey on that hole was like phenomenal.
I know, but I've hit some clunkers. There's no doubt.
That's kind of part of it. I think what people don't realize, that I always tell people, like, when people are watching golf on TV, they're watching, like, the 10 best players that are playing well that week, right?
Yeah.
They're
yes.
knowing all the other stuff that we end up doing,
Yeah, and I think the best part about it is the worst part about it is golf gives you so much time to think.
Right.
And after you just hit a clunker, you got to hit it again.
Right.
And, it's going through your mind. But I think what separates the best, the good ones from the okay ones is how you handle that and how you come back on the next shot or the next round or something.
A lot of people ask that question. How do you? What is that? Like, what is that moment you said? You said it before. You had a little chat with yourself.
Yeah. Well, I mean, hey. I just figure, I'm not that bad. And I know I'm going to hit some shots, and I know I'm going to hit some good shots, and I know I'm going to make some birdies. It's more of an inner just, okay, you messed up. Let's get our stuff together and get back at it. It's more of a And as you know, I probably didn't do anything the best out there, you know, not, but I was a grinder. Yep. And I grinded for probably 90% of my wins, and that's just kind of the way I grew up playing.
Right. Yeah. I mean, I think there's a lot of us that kind of, you rarely do you go through a tournament where you hit every shot perfect, right? And so many people think that, oh, you must have played great. It's like, not necessarily, you know, I mean, par putts.
Or yeah.
Like to win a tournament, I had to make good par putts, right? I had to make those putts when you really needed to make it. Yeah, you're going to make birdie, but it's that one or two pars that you made that you're like, oh, you know, game changer.
Exactly. And it's you know, if you have a good ball striking round, you're hitting 14 greens. I mean, that's 14, 15 greens. That's a good ball striking round. So it's what you do with those other three or four. And when you throw in some birdies.
Yep. Exactly. So, all right. Speaking of grinding, what's on your playlist when you're practicing?
Well, it's changed. I'm more right now of a The Weeknd or Khalid or I don't know. I've just kind of gotten into that mode a little bit more. Billie Eilish. I used to listen to a lot of country, and I still listen to country, but I've gotten more into Sam Smith That type of music.
Yeah, I love it. Me too. We're similar.
Yeah.
So besides me, who was one of your favorite players to be paired with in a tournament, and why?
There's no one.
No one.
No. Just you. Just you.
I mean, come on.
No. You know who I really loved playing growing up was Ayako Okamoto. I love being paired with her. I mean, a lot of probably people don't know who she is, but she was really the first Japanese player to come over here and be successful and make it on tour to build a pathway to the other Japanese coming over. But I love playing with her. She had such great hands and such a great feel. I mean, I'm not even sure she even listened to her caddy. She just kind of just, you know, went by – No. Total feel. You know, I love playing with Laura Davies. You know, I like people that kind of get in and get out. You were one of those. The people that take forever to play with, even though they're maybe nice off the golf course, just like nails on the chalkboard. And you know, I've been fortunate. You know, Pat Hurst is probably one of my best friends, and we play a lot of golf together. I love playing with her too. So.
I love that you talked about Ayako too, because I think from our era, she'd probably be on everybody's top five favorite player to play with list. You know, the tempo of her swing and everything was just,
it was great.
Her every shot, you know, and you never knew that.
And you know what? You couldn't really tell if she was shooting 66 or 76. She was going to have a nice sake when she got done and move on. Lorena Ochoa, also of the younger generation was just, I just enjoyed being with her a lot.
Similar kind of mode, right?
Just exactly. Exactly. Cool. Yeah.
I love it. Okay. If you had one golf course to play for the rest of your life, just one, which one would it be?
Muirfield Village, Columbus, Ohio.
Wow.
To me, a lot of things go into that. For just me personally, one, the golf course, you know, every day it plays different. Two, the practice facilities are amazing. And then the food is unbelievable.
That's a trifecta.
Yeah, trifecta. So, I mean,
That's good. I love it.
Yeah, I mean, if I'm going to play a golf course every day, they got to have good food and they have to have good practice facilities.
Yeah. I could do without the practice, but I'm with the
food. Of course.
You know me. But anyway, each is on, right?
Yeah, exactly.
So who inspires you these days? Like, you're still playing golf. Like, you are still out there competing. You compete on the LPGA, you compete on the Legends, you know, who inspires you to keep going?
Myself. I mean, really, I mean, no one tells me to play. Yeah. I just, you know, I think I started late in my career, like at 15, and I played other sports, and golf just always enamored me about how you can never really conquer it. I mean, if you win once in a year or twice in a year, you've had a great year. So you're learning to lose a lot.
Yeah.
And I don't know, it just always intrigues me, you know, trying to get better. And I the golf swing has changed so much over the years. You know, we never grew up with video. We never grew up. We just went out and played. I mean, I played more than I ever practiced. And I think I grew up in a golf course called Pasquiempo, and the range stunk. Great golf course, Alistair McKenzie golf course. And I grew up at a golf course that I didn't know that was great. It's the only golf course I ever known. So I played a lot. And then, you know, when I went to college, I kind of saw practice facilities and I just enjoy as you said, listening to music and just the solidarity of it being outside. Yeah. And you got nobody but yourself.
Yeah.
You don't have anybody telling you what to do. It's the best job in the world.
I say that we had the best job in the world. You know, I don't play as much anymore, but there's not a time that I don't go on the golf course and just think, God, I love being on the golf course. I never really say that, you know. I don't miss competing, but man, when I go on the course, I just love being out there. You know, you said, like, it's just, there's something about being, I always say, like, I've never been on a bad golf course, you know, really, as far as that feeling of solitude and being able to. I want to ask you something about Pasquiempo, one of my really favorite places in the world as well. It's such a beautiful golf course, beautiful club. But Marion Hollins,
yes,
who had a very important role in the development of Pasquiempo, is getting inducted to the Hall of Fame this year. Can you tell us a little bit about Marion and what you know about her as it relates to Pasquiempo?
Yeah, she actually owned the golf course. She developed the land and the golf course. You know, she wasn't just one that just came in. I mean, it was her project, her baby from start to finish. And she was really a woman, not only sport-wise, but she was an amazing business person. And
what years was that, Julie? Like, what are we talking about?
Talking about, well, she probably played in the 30s, late 20s, 30s. But she had so much respect, not only from the women, but from the men. I mean, her dad, it was in the steel company. They were from back east. She was an equestrian. But golf was her passion. And she got out here and bought the land, developed the land. And then that really got to know Bobby Jones and Alistair McKenzie. And then they put this little golf course together at Cypress Point.
And then
Bobby Jones brought her back to do Augusta. And that's when the war came and they had to kind of shut it down. But she had all the plans and all the stuff kind of mapped out. So,
for a woman, but I mean, because really, I mean, I learned about Marion while just being at Pasquiempo a few times. And because there's, you know, really there and stories about her there. But it's really not a name that we all know. It's like, oh, Marion, not like, oh, Bobby Jones. And you know what I mean? I mean, so it's really interesting that she played such an important role as a woman.
Yeah. And the thing is, I mean, she not only developed it, but she won the U.S. Amateur. She was the first captain for the Curtis Cup. She had a huge influence on women's golf and playing. But I think mostly it was more architectural and designer and businesswoman than basically her golf career. But, you know, I was on the first selection process, and the last two times she's been really close to getting in and hasn't been able to get in. And I think the more and more we all talked about it and stuff, you know, everybody started to really read and realize, man, this lady is impressive. Yeah. And
like, how is
really
she not hit, right? And how is she missing on any trials, right?
Yeah, and especially where we are with the diversity and the dynamics of where women, I mean, I think everybody was like, I mean, she was so far behind before her times that, I mean, well, why isn't she in? And it's great that she's getting in now with Tiger and Susie Burning and Tim Fincham.
Very cool. I know, it's great. It's It's a great class this year. So anyway, I wanted to ask you that because I know that she's so connected to Paso Tiempo, and that's your place.
That's my jam.
Shift a little bit from golf. What do you got to be binge watching something, right? I'm on my third binge right now. Please.
Well, we definitely crushed Schitt's Creek. Oh my God, it's hilarious, and it's so well done, and Paula's gonna kill me, but Alexis reminds me of Paula, just Paula Kramer. Oh my God, she's gonna kill me. But so we watched Schitt's Creek. We watched Justified. It was good. Now we're watching Designated Survivor right now. We've watched some movies. We never watch movies.
Yeah.
And so we've been watching some movies. I've never seen Shawshank Redemption. So we watched that, and oh my God, it was amazing.
Yeah.
So I'm trying not to watch a lot of TV, just because I don't want to turn it on at 2 o'clock. But, we've been watching in the evening, definitely.
Yeah, we have too.
Watched Schitt's Creek?
I watched a couple, the first few episodes of it, and then got going on something else. It's on the list of I think we have three or four going right now. Gotta get back to that one. So,
the good thing about Schitt's Creek, it's 20, 25 minutes, and you're on
they're
the next
quick.
One. Next
exactly.
One. Yeah, they're quick. Yeah. So,
I know. I can't go. Whenever you see one as 10 seasons, and you're like, oh my God. I mean, I know I've got nothing but time right now, but that's a little ridiculous.
I know. I want to start Breaking Bad, but I'm not sure I really want to start Breaking Bad. You know?
So Juli, you have two daughters, Haley and Corey. They're not at home, right? They work elsewhere, or they are living elsewhere, or are they with you as well?
Yeah. So Haley, my oldest, just turned 30. Unbelievable. Yeah. We're old.
Yeah.
And she lives in the city with her boyfriend, and they work at a company called Survey Monkey.
Yep.
And so Haley's been there just out of college, so she's been there a while. We see them a lot. We see them on the weekends mostly. And then my youngest is Corey, and she's 26, and she's living in Ireland with her boyfriend. Also, they both work for Survey Monkey. They've been right in Dublin. They've been there for just over a year. They moved there to try to travel and see the world, and they did it kind of the first eight, 9 months, and now they're locked in their apartment, and but they're going. They've both been going out a couple years, so Brian and I both like them. They're good guys, and we have a lot of fun with them. So as you know, it's a different dynamics right now, but. I can't wait to get her back because I miss her, a lot.
I'm sure. It's a hard to be that far away. Well, speaking of your kids, there's a question from one of the viewers that I wanted to ask you because it's relative. Might not get the person's name right, but it's the Jan Ennis. I don't know what her name is, but that's her handle. And I'm going to read what she wrote, what she asked. She said, "Of the many years assisting Juli in her player transportation at the Phoenix tournament, she's one of the greatest human beings on the planet. If you need a question for an interview, here's one." So here's the question. "As Juli traveled for years with young children, given the challenges of tour travel for players who have younger children, what advice or tips can you give players currently on tour who are balancing professional golf and parenting?"
Well, it's not only professional golf, it's a woman in the workplace that are balancing being a mom and working and all that. But I struggled with it for a long time because my mom was a stay-at-home mom, and I had Haley, and after 6 weeks, we didn't have maternity leave. At 6 weeks, I came back and started playing, and not well. But I struggled with being gone and not being with her 24/7. But over the years, it took me about 3 or 4 years to realize I'm spending a ton of time with her. She's traveling with me every week.
Right.
We stayed in private housing a lot. We stayed in We didn't have Airbnbs. We stayed at Residence Inn and stuff like that. But I think the thing, the gist is, one, don't feel like you have to make up for being gone. Just be yourself. Spend as much time as you can. I mean, I remember being in my golf clothes all day long because as soon as I got home, I put my mom hat on and, you know, we were at the park and I wanted to give them baths and I wanted to do all that. I did have a nanny travel with me for 13 years and I really loved just the being consistent with having someone there all the time. Yeah. And and Brian was a huge help. I'm traveling around with the kids. He would come out on his week off and come visit me watching golf. So it's hard. You can do it. It's hard. But I think the most thing is you can't give in. You got to be consistent, whether you're on the road or at home.
Yeah. And Julie, and you traveled with the girls. I remember, before we had, daycare, which the LPGA yes. now offers, LPGA daycare, which is really awesome. And kids were able to, or moms were able to drop the kids off there and feel secure. But I know that you and a bunch of other moms traveled with kids. And I mean, more power to you. I mean, yeah. But
I have to say,
Kelly are great girls. I mean, they are. Doesn't know them. They are. They're great girls. They're so you, and they're great kids, well, and they're full adults, and it all worked, right?
But piggybacking on that too, they are great girls. But I had great friends out there that treated my kids like theirs. You, Meg, Beth, Webby, Pat. I mean, it was a family out there. And, when I was in having lunch with the girls, you'd saddle right up with them and eat with them. And I got to tell you a funny Webby story is Webby stayed after to watch Kelly Robbins at the Open, the playoff. And she had a private plane all set up to go from Portland up to Canada for the next tournament. And, I had the van and I had all my stuff in it. We were going to drive. And Webby calls me that night and said, "Hey, Jules, I have a plane set up. I can't cancel it. Do you and the girls want to fly up there?" And I'm like, "Yeah." So the next day we get there and Gregor, my caddy, ended up driving the van to Canada. And so we're walking up and Corey was probably, I want to say maybe five, maybe six. And she goes, are we going on this plane? And I go, yeah. And I told her why. And she goes, "Oh my God, I love that Corey Webb." So every time Corey sees her, she goes, "I love that Corey Webb." So, I mean, just stuff like that. I mean, my kids have been so fortunate, when Meg and Beth and they have birthdays, my kids call them and, it is a family out there. And that yeah.
I mean, we did, we started our lives together out there and we were the only people we had before cell phones, before.
Anything. Oh yeah.
We
had maps.
Big ones.
We had the big 3A maps and we're trying to get, oh my gosh.
Oh yeah. Those were the days.
Yeah.
I know when people have problems using the GPS, I'm like, you have no idea. Yeah, I have no idea. Hey, before I get to my last question, I just wanted to have a shout out. I'm sure you the same to our tournaments that are postponed until next year. Unfortunately, Legends schedule at this point has pretty much moved all to 2021. We do have the BJ's Charity Classic still in place in September, but in a few weeks you were set to defend the Squamish Clearwater Legends Cup, and they're postponing until 2021 and coming back and French Lick and Senior LPGA and Senior Open will all be back next year. But I wanted to do a shout out to them because not only is it our sponsors, but all the people that are involved in the tournament. It takes an army of people to put on an event. And I know everyone's disappointed, and I'm sure you are as well. You're defending at Squamish.
Yeah, we can't do it without sponsors, and we can't do this without volunteers. And, our main priority now is get the United States back in running full circle, running up and running, I should say. But yes, not only the sponsors for the Legends, but sponsors for the LPGA, because I mean, we got a lot of rookies just starting out trying to make, you know, can you imagine that you'd be climbing the walls right now if you're a rookie just trying to get out there. I mean, all these older veteran players having the opportunity just to compete, and again, just to be with each other and talk about old stories and stuff like that. I mean, it means a lot to us to be able to do this. And, you know, I hope everybody's back, and I hope we can keep growing this, because we got a lot of good youngins coming up that want to play on the Legends Tour. So, we got the person that's going to run this thing right here. So, Jane, you know, you're doing a great job. And
Thank you. It's been great. And it is. It's about, you know, I feel like, We had these amazing careers playing golf, and I really feel like it's our chance to kind of continue it, be able to see each other, like you said, and also have something, you know, for the players that are behind us, you know, because you get done playing at 35 or 40 and you might have a family or not. It's still fun to compete. I mean, I'm, you know, half the time I play, I'm stinking, but, you know, I still like competing. And I know you do as well. So yes, we do. We appreciate all of our sponsors, and we'll be back next year. So
I think the thing we do best on the Legend, I think we, the thing we do best on Legend Tour is we crush the after 5 hour.
We do that really well.
Yes.
Really. And a lot of times with our pro-am partners. Crushing by ourselves even. Right?
We don't care. You know, we put a full day in on that golf course and we're going to enjoy it.
Keep going.
You know, we don't go back to our room and chip and putt and, you know, and worry about it. We just go out and have fun. And you know, I've met some great people in the pro-ams and some that I call some of my best friends. And everybody says, oh, my gosh, how many pro-ams have you played in? I've played in quite a bit. And I have to say, I have really never had a bad pro-am group. I mean, it's really what the pro makes of it, and how you go out there and kibitz and give them crap, and you know, so they're the ones that are footing the bills, and you know, that's where we as I think the LPGA and all the Legends Tour do a great job.
I agree. I don't think anybody can do it better. I mean, it sounds cliche, but I put it up against anybody, any sport, anywhere. I agree with that. All right, one last question before we go, okay? What are you cooking tonight?
Shoot. Well, tonight we're actually doing takeout. But tomorrow night, spare ribs. We're doing spare ribs. Yeah. But we've been doing
– I only need two. So just so you know – no.
Two? Oh, my gosh. So we've been doing fish. We've been doing salads. I'm trying not to eat as much as I usually do, because I'm not getting as much exercise, but I'll tell you, when it's morning, afternoon, and dinner, I'm ready to go.
Totally. I mean, we're eating every meal together, breakfast, lunch, and dinner. It's amazing. Yeah. It's like, oh, my God, it's exhausting.
there's Brian. I'm sending him out. Yeah. And the dog.
And of course, and the dog.
Yeah. So yeah, but
my camera, because it's my messy office. But next time we'll say hello.
Yeah. Hey, exactly.
Julie, thank you so much for taking the time. This was awesome. Well.
Oh my God.
We'll do it again. Time and good luck with your rehab. I hope everything goes great. And you're back on the course and you're back in practicing. You know, putting. I know, putting, chipping. I just want to tell everybody that we're going to be doing this every week on Thursdays at 4 o'clock next week. I'll be talking to Michelle McGann. So thank you for everyone joining. Thanks again, Julie, and take care. Okay.
Thanks, Jane. Thanks for having me on. Hi to the
fam. You're welcome. Okay.
Okay.
Thanks.
See ya.
Bye.